Hi, I'm Trevor Ware. I'm a staff programmer at Blackbird Interactive, and I've been working on Hardspace Shipbreaker for the last 4 years.
Hi, I'm David Perdigan, and I've been an VFX and concept artist at Blackbird Interactive for the last 3 years.
In Hardspace Shipbreaker, you play as a shipbreaker that works in a shipyard for a company that sends you derelict spaceships. Your job is to strip these ships down and salvage all the valuable materials within them. It's an extremely dangerous job, and there's a ton of ways that you can die. And when you die, the company clones you and throws you back in the yard to repeat the cycle.
Our agenda for this talk will be to introduce you to the VFX graph editor and data-driven VFX in Unity, to walk you through the VFX and code setup, and to give you a demo of how we work in Engine. The visual effects graph is a specialized tool to create complex visual effects in Unity using an intuitive visual interface. It allows us, among many other things, to control each and every one of the parameters of our effects, to change and reuse them in different ways without having to create a brand new effect for each variation, saving us time and work. It is a next generation tool inspired by film visual effects software that allows the artist to create incredible visual effects for video games without writing any code. It uses a node system. Nodes connect together to perform a series of calculations that input into blocks, which in turn define particle properties, similar to Unity Shader Graph tool, though not identical. The first node, Spawn, defines how many particles will be spawned and when. Initialized particles will define their initial values, size, speed, direction, lifetime, etc. Update particle will control how the particles behave over time, color variations, gravity, size variation, etc. The output node will define how the particles are rendered, shaders used, textures, material properties, etc. Here we can see one simple example of one of the multiple particle systems that we are going to see today. Many properties of particles can be exposed, but we can also create our own parameters. This will depend on the needs of our project. At Hardspace, we needed explosions to be able to dynamically resize, change color, or be affected by external forces. Also, the explosion had to change the properties depending on the element that caused it, such as electricity or fuel. In order to do that, I created three different exposed parameters. The first one, size, it's a float range that goes from 1 to 5. This is because the smallest explosion in the game is 1 meter, and the biggest one is 5 meters. Color, a simple color gradient, and speed, a simple float by default 0. These parameters will modify any value of any other node, and it is the artist who has control on each and every one of them. In this example, we can see how the size parameter is spread throughout all the particle system of our effects to modify and change the values of them as needed. Let's see it more in detail. In this example, we are going to see how to modify the size parameter to change the amount of particles that the effects will have. Size now is set to 2, because it is a 2-meter explosion. We are going to fit that value into a remap float node, where the old range value is 1 to 5. And we are going to set a new range that goes, for this specific particle system, from 200 to 1000 particles. We fit the final value into the spawn node, and the final number is automatically calculated to 400 particles when the effect size is equal to 2. As you see, the size value not necessarily will change the size of the particles, but any other value that we want. And with the remap float node, it is pretty easy. As you see here, a size 1 explosion will use the minimum particles that we set, 200. A size 3 will use a number automatically calculated by the tool, here 600. And the size 5 will use the maximum particles that we set, 1000 for this Spark system. But let's go a little bit further. We are going to take the same value, but before fit the remap float node, we are going to subtract 1 from the size value. Then, we remap the old range from 0 to 30 and we fit it into the same spawn node. As you see, the final number is 0. This means that when explosions are smaller than 2 meters, the number of particles in this debris particle system will be 0. Only explosion bigger than 2 will include debris particles in it. This is a 2-meter explosion, and as we can see, it is pretty simple. It has only a few fires and smoke animations plus the particles that we saw before. However, the 5-meter explosion has more details in it, like the debris particle system, but the size parameter can be used to modify any other value that we need. Like in here, the same size has been used to modify speed, lifetime, and size of the sparse particles that we saw in the first example. We have two other parameters, colors and speed, that control only one aspect of the effect. Color will change the set color over life node of almost every particle system in the effects, and speed will change the set value in this force node on the majority of the system. But Trevor will talk more in detail about these two later. This is the final result. As you see, the explosion now can change not only the size of each of the particles, but the size of the entire effect and the number of details on bigger explosions. At this point, the effect is done and ready for implementation. But we are not doing only one, we are doing 4 different explosions. We can now repeat the same process and create the other 3, or we can take advantage of the VFX graph editor and include any variation of the same effects in the same graph asset. In order to do that, we need events. Events are connected to the spawn node, and they will tell the particles when they should be played and which one should be played. In this example, we can see that the event 1 will play the particles 1, but the event 2 will play both particles 1 and 2. However, the event 3 is connected to the stop part of the spawn node. So this event will stop the particles 2, but it won't affect the particles 1. Let's see a real example of events in our effect. I know, it looks complex, but it isn't. Let's simplify. As you see here, fire, fuel X, and electric explosion events are connected to the same spark system that we saw in the first example. These sparks are a common system used by almost any explosion, but not the cryo one. Cryo is connected to a different set of particle system. Electric explosion is connected to sparks and smoke, two of the common particle system, but also it is connected to an exclusive set of particles created only for the electric explosion. Let's see how the final product looks like. So now I'm going to test the effects. So I have the effects here in the scene and in the VFX graph editor window. I have all the exposed parameters and the events right here that we can send in this window. So I'm going to start with the fire explosion. I'm going to test first the smallest one, and I'm going to send the fire event. That's looking nice. I'm going to try a bigger number, let's say 3.5. Looking good. And a bigger one. That's nice. As you can see, the biggest explosion have more details in it. I'm going to change to the cryo color. That side is good. I'm going to send cryo, smallest number. That's cool. Let's try the electric explosion. Electric explosion are not bigger than 2 meters. So I'm not going to test it in numbers bigger than 2, but as you can see, it spawns some electric arcs that are exclusive to this effect. And the last one is the fuel X explosion, similar to the fire one with a different color set. Let's try the biggest one. Super cool. And right here we have another value, that this speed, these add a force to the effects, so it makes the effects move into a specific direction. See, let's do a bigger number. You see? Trevor will talk more in detail about this, but it's working perfectly. Cool, that's it. ready for implementation.
Now let's dive into the code setup of how we data drive our explosions. Here's a quick agenda of what we're going to talk about today, including parameter setup, event setup, how we store our data, how we spawn the visual effect, how we set the data on the visual effect, and finally how we play the visual effect. First, let's talk about how we set up the visual effect parameters in code. We create unique identifiers using the names of the exposed parameters from our visual effect graph. We do this by calling shader.property2id on the name of the parameter. In code, we use these unique identifiers wherever we would have referenced the name of the parameter, such as when we're setting shader values. Similarly, we create unique identifiers for our events using the event names from the visual effect graphs. The reason we use these unique identifiers is because it's more efficient than using the string names when setting shader values. Now let's talk about how we're going to store the data. I've created this small class that stores a float for the size of the explosion, a gradient for the color of the explosion, and an enum for the type of explosion. It also stores a reference to the visual effect graph prefab that will be spawned when the object explodes. In Unity, there are several different ways you could store the data. For example, it could be stored on a mono behavior on a prefab, or it could be stored in a scriptable object. On Shipbreaker, most of our data is stored in scriptable objects that are referenced by our prefabs. The reason for this is so that we can reuse those scriptable objects on prefabs that share similar characteristics. And if we ever wanted to change that data, we don't have to change every prefab, just that one scriptable object, and all the prefabs that reference that object would be updated automatically. On the right, we have four different examples of our data. Notice they all reference the same visual effect prefab. When the object that references this data explodes, they're all going to spawn the same visual effect, but because the data that accompanies it is different, they're all going to look unique. Now let's talk about how we're going to spawn the visual effect when an object explodes. To account for motion, the first thing we're going to do is grab the velocity off the rigid body of the object. Then we need to calculate how we're going to orient the explosion. If the object is in motion, we're going to point it facing the direction of motion using quaternion.lookRotation on the velocity. If it's not moving, we're just going to use the object's rotation. The reason we point the explosion in the direction of motion is so that all we need to do is pass a float for speed to the visual effect graph. This allows David to modify the speed however he likes to make the particles look the best without needing to worry about maintaining the directionality of velocity. This means that we only need to set the z component of the velocity vector in force nodes in our VFX graph. Then we're going to instantiate the effect using GameObject.instantiate, using the visual effect graph prefab from our data, the object's position, and the rotation we just calculated. Once we have the instance of the explosion, we're going to get the visual effect component off of it so we can start setting data on it. The first parameter we're going to set is the size, using the float we defined in our data earlier. Below are two examples of the same explosion, one at size 1 and one at size 2. The next parameter we're going to set is the color, using the gradient we defined in our data. Here are two explosions, one that has a gradient of blue and one that's gradient is purple. Finally, we're going to set the speed parameter by taking the magnitude of the velocity we got from the rigid body earlier. Here's one explosion at 5 meters per second and one that's at 15 meters per second. Lastly, we need to tell the visual effect to play. We do this by sending an event to the visual effect graph. We do a switch statement on the type of explosion we defined in our data. Depending on the explosion type, we send the corresponding event identifier to the visual effect graph. This leads us into our in-engine demo. We've created four different data sets and attached them to four different explosive props in our game. Here's the first prop, which is a small fire explosive canister. It uses the fire explosion type. The next prop is a medium-sized coolant canister, and it uses the cryo explosion type. Next is a medium-sized electrical junction box, and it uses the electric explosion type. And finally, here's the large fuel canister, and it uses the Fuel X explosion type. So overall, Unity's visual effect graph is a very powerful tool. It allows us to data drive our visual effects by letting us expose parameters that can be controlled by our code and our data. Using events, we can make our effects multi-purposed, and we can build those effects with variation in mind, meaning that we can tweak our data to make each effect look different without needing to create new effects every time we want to make a small change. That concludes our presentation. Thank you for attending this Unite Now session on data-driven explosions. We hope you learned a lot. Please check the Unite Now page for more information.